Welcome back to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit voice. I'm Bobby Keys, and we are telling the stories of nonprofits, not just in Kansas City, but all across the nation. It was a great interview that we just had with John Navin and Associates, the Navin Group, and awesome information with financial planning and charitable giving. Now, we're going to be talking about helping teens with reentry, teens specifically that have been incarcerated or on probation, all youth. And there's a program called One Heart Project, and we have the CEO of the project, Mr. Steve Rich. How are you, sir?
I'm great, Bobby. Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing great. So tell us a little bit about One Heart. What is One Heart?
Yeah, the One Heart Project is a initiative that gives kids who are in the juvenile justice system a true second chance. It's a holistic solution that is designed to provide these youth with the skills and tools that they might need, and a network of healthy relationships to help them navigate life.
Yeah,
and it's collaborative. We've got a lot of partners that are participating with us, and it's just a way to really work with this underserved population and help them get that second chance.
So you have mentors and you provide mentors, education and training and programs like that to help these youth. They do. I guess how does that work? Do you go into the jails or the programs where the youth are, and do you talk to them, or are they referred to you? How does that work?
Yeah, so it really all works through relationship and having great partners. So we love coming in and working collaboratively with leadership of different correctional facilities, whether it's at the state level or the county level. And the first thing we do is ask, what do you need? Where are the kids at that you're working with? You're doing great work. It's tough work. How can we help? Once we identify what those needs are, we develop a collaborative relationship with the leadership of those counties or states. And oftentimes we're working with kids that are housed in correctional facilities. Other times we're working with youth that are back in the community. They're under county supervision, for example, but they're still obviously in the juvenile justice system. And we'll work together to identify those youth that they seem to be best fit for an initiative like this. So, for example, if we're working with a correctional facility, we'll develop relationship with those youth while they're in facility. We'll deploy some social-emotional intelligence curriculum. Connect them with a one-on-one mentor relationship, provide what we call gap skill training, and then walk with them through post-release and back when they're in the free world again as well.
When you go in, that's awesome that you're able to get in before they get out of the correctional facility, and then you kind of walk them through afterwards, and you kind of get to see them grow. When you see them kind of change, when you see first let's talk about the beginning, when you go and meet some of these youth. What is that? Are they kind of resistant to what you're trying to help them with, or are they understand that this is what they need in life to kind of survive and be successful?
Yeah, I think really, Bobby, the kids that we're working with are, you hate to categorize people, but I would say a large number of these youth come from very difficult circumstances.
Yeah.
I think the public tends to think that when they think about kids in the correction system, they think that these are kids who are bad kids and they're getting what they deserve, and I'm glad they don't live in my neighborhood kind of a thing. And, the reality is much different.
Yeah.
Most come from challenging circumstances. And oftentimes when they've made choices that are not good, those choices have been made out of survival as well. So really what we find is that like you or me or my kids, the kids who are in the juvenile justice system need to know that somebody cares about them.
Mm-hmm.
They need to know that there's hope for something better than what they have, and they want to belong to, yeah. to people and to relationship. And so I think, you know, programs are great, and we certainly have elements, program elements in what we do, but really the thing that changes lives is relationship. Yep. And there are very few people on the face of the planet that don't want to be in relationship with yeah. somebody, and in a healthy relationship. So yeah, I think they're excited about the opportunity to be in relationship with somebody who will care about them.
Yeah. You know, I was just going through my mind, and whenever we talk about kids and growing up, that, you know, that that's the first thing that comes to my mind, you know, is their relationship, you know, with a family or lack of, typically, because I come from that same type of environment. You know, I luckily avoided correctional facilities. My brothers didn't. You know, and I could have very easily gone down that, and it took me a long time to realize it, but you know, there was a relationship that kept me from going down that path. And that's what, you know, interviewing people. And I know you're a TV producer, right? I think you're, you know, a veteran filmmaker and documentarian, you get to interview people. And, you know, when you interview people and you hear experts talk about things that have happened in kids' lives or, you know, where they come from, it all comes back to the relationships or the lack of. And, you know, and with what you guys are doing, that's what it seems like you keep pounding. It's like, it's about the relationship. It's about the relationship. Everything boils down to that one solid relationship in life.
Yeah, it really does. And I'll tell you, you know, how this kind of started was we were collecting information, doing some research for a movie that we're in production on, mm-hmm. based on a true story that took place a few years back. And it involves the juvenile justice population, sitting down with some of the kids that were a part of this story and talking to them about their stories and their lives and their backstories and getting information to get the film produced. And one of the young men, his name is Mac White, mm-hmm. And Mac shared his story with me as kind of an aside at a moment when there was a break in the conversation. He said, "By the way, I'm being released to go home tomorrow." And I said, "Well, congratulations, you must be very excited." He said, "No, sir, I'm terrified." I said, "Really, tell me why." Well, that he began to tell me his whole story. He said, "You know, when I was a child, my family situation wasn't great. My dad wasn't around a lot. My mom had issues. And really, when I was young, I was raising myself and my little mm-hmm. sister really by myself. Yep. And witnessed my first murder when I was 12. Mm-hmm. My best friend and I were playing two-on-two basketball on the playground against two 18-year-olds. He was 13, I was 12. We beat them, and we just beat two 18-year-olds. We're all excited. We're celebrating. We didn't know they were gang members. One of them got mm-hmm. mad that we were celebrating, reached into his bag, pulled out a gun, and shot my friend in the head.
Oh, wow.
He said, I thought I was next, but they turned and ran. But my best friend bled out on my lap on the playground."
Oh.
And, you know, then it was just kind of from there, in and out of different foster homes. Mm. Those situations weren't healthy. By the time he was 15, he said, "I was out on the street figuring I'd just go it on my own, sleeping in abandoned cars and abandoned buildings. And, you know, I robbed these two people. I knew what I did was wrong, but I didn't know how else I was going to eat."
Yeah.
And, you know, it's things that most of us don't think about. So I think those kinds of circumstances that many of these youth go through, you know, the challenges that they face are not of their own doing. Now, certainly if they've committed a crime,
yeah.
that is of their own doing. But I think, you know, we're looking at a nation that is changing its views on sentencing and punishment for kids who've committed nonviolent crimes. So there are a lot of good things happening around these kids, but they're in need of people who care. And you know, we've seen when you surround these youth with people who care about them,
mm-hmm.
and give them the tools that maybe they've not had the chance to access to date, it's like putting a plant or a flower in good soil,
yeah.
and when watering it, they have a chance to really grow and flourish. And we've seen that happen with a number of young men and women.
That's awesome too, because you know a lot of people don't realize the things that have gone on in people's lives, and you know I learned this at a later age. You touched on it before. You only come from two places: a place of love or a place of survival, right? And what I'd like to see and what I'd love to see is like the people who transition. You know, where you finally go back from coming from a place of survival and you start to change your views and you start to feel that love. What does that look like for you? I mean, you know, I don't know if you, what does that look like when that change happens? You know, when you see these youth change.
Yeah, it's really pretty remarkable. And there's such a you know, it's not all black and white, right?
Yeah,
there's so many layers to all of this. And so, you know, when a mentor begins visiting a young man, for example, in a correctional facility and begins developing a relationship with him, oftentimes it might not be for five or six weeks or more before that youth actually begins to open up, because they really have not, many of them have not had relationships that have had any stickiness in their lives, yeah. Right? They're people that they've cared about or they thought cared about them are all gone. They've left them. They've hurt them. And so trust, you know, takes time. And oftentimes in the beginning, some kids might really try and push that mentor away because their mentality is, you're going to leave me soon anyway. Mm-hmm. It's less painful if you just leave now,
yeah,
before I start caring. And so they might test them or try to push them away at the beginning emotionally. And then, you know, when they find out that the mentor is going to stick around or that the curriculum facilitator is going to stick around or that people that are training them on the gap skills are going to stick around and stay there for week after week, then oftentimes the youth will understand that, you know, we're not going anywhere and we're here for them in the long haul. And then they begin to open up and build relationship. And, you know, we've seen really wonderful things happen. And we've seen, Bobby, young men and young women that have turned around and they've got remarkable lives now. I mean, they're, you know, we've got a young man who, when he came out, we've been walking with him when he came out. He went into a job at a law firm with some wonderful people that gave him a chance.
Wow.
And he saved all his money, rode the bus every day, saved all his money up in that job. And he said, Steve, I've always wanted to drive a truck. That's been my dream ever since I was a kid, you know? And so he saved all that money up and he bought a truck and started driving a truck cross country. And then he saved his money up from that first truck, bought a second truck, and now he's got a little trucking company.
Wow.
We've got another young man who always wanted to be an actor and a model, and mm-hmm. he got signed by an agency and was in a national Samsung commercial, and now he's been in three movies and a play. And you know, it's just there are wonderful stories of people who have taken the advantage of the opportunity they've been given. We haven't done this for these kids,
yeah.
You know, we've just given them a little bit of a help. And they've taken advantage and done the work, and they've gotten to a place that's really quite healthy.
So how do you find the mentors? Do people come to you and say, I want a mentor, or do you kind of go out and handpick them and they're specific?
Yeah, we need people like you to broadcast it.
Hey, we'll help as much as we can. We got you.
Yeah, no, I mean, yeah, I think mentors really is the most challenging thing that for us to find, because I think people are nervous.
Yeah.
You know, they. We had a mentor who we lined up for a youth in Texas, and by the way, we've got a bunch of great stuff going on in Kansas and Kansas City, and so. But this particular story happened in Texas, and so when the mentor was driving down, we background screened him, trained him, and mm-hmm. all that. But he's driving down for that first meeting, and he called me, and he's nervous. And I just gave him a little pep talk. Well, he told me afterward that when he went down, walked into the correctional facility, he was bracing himself that he might have a physical altercation with this kid.
Oh wow!
And so he started thinking about, how am I going to respond to that? He said, Steve, when I sat down and looked across the table at this young man and started having conversation with him, I realized he was just like my own son.
Yeah.
My whole perspective changed. And And they played a board game together, and he said he noticed that the young man was cheating while they were playing the board game, and he thought to himself, oh, first meeting, I'm going to have to confront him about cheating. I hate this. But as he watched more closely, he saw that the boy was cheating in a way that made the mentor win. And so he asked him about it afterwards. He said, you know, what was going on there? Looked like you were cheating. And the boy said, I'm so sorry. And he said, but it looked like you were cheating so that I could win. What's the deal with that? And the boy said, I wanted you to come back.
Oh, good Lord. That is...
So it's a lot different, I think, than people think when they think about what will it be like to mentor. And what you find is, in most cases, a young person, male or female, that just really wants a relationship with somebody that cares. So we need a lot of folks in your area to step up and say, I'll be a mentor.
Absolutely. Now, how can people find you? We only got a minute left. So how can people get a hold of you? How can they join?
They can go to oneheart.com, which is our national website, or in your area, they can go to oneheart.com/KCMI.
KCMI.
Yeah, and that'll take them directly to the Kansas, Missouri website, and they can go either place, so oneheart.com or oneheart.com/KCMI, or they can just Google search us and find us. But, you know, it's going to take a lot of people to change the lives of these kids, and the more we can get involved, the more we'll be able to transform.
Well, Steve, thank you very much for joining us. We're going to do everything that we can to help get involved. When we'd love to be involved with the Kansas City chapter and the Kansas City arm of your nonprofit organization, and we'd love to have you on again. There's a lot that we can, you know, maybe we can help you do, and you can shed some light.
Thank you, Bobby. We'd love that. We sure appreciate it.
Well, thanks, Steve. And thank you for listening to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit voice, produced by Charitable Communications and generously underwritten by the Kauffman Foundation. Like what you hear, support our efforts and sharing the stories of nonprofits. Underwriting opportunities are available at kccaresonline.org. Podcasts are also available at kccaresonline.org. And you can also sign up to be a guest, share our social media. You can find all the information there. Thank you for listening to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit voice on ESPN 1510 and 94.5 FM.